see it. I don't have access to that, so...
He was lowered into a covered tank of water.
Mm-hmm.
And he started having chest pains, apparently.
Mm.
And he pulled out just in the time. So, well, why wasn't he able to escape? Or he would have drowned. So,
I don't know.
So the trick didn't work, in other words.
Bingo.
Or did he start having a heart attack? Or did he start having chest pains before he had an opportunity
and
to...
therefore couldn't complete his escape.
Pull a phone.
I'd like to see you in one of those things right now.
Why? Because I asked you to do something, you can't get it done?
Got it done within 2 minutes. They got the answer back.
No, but
they got to get their ducks in a row, make sure it's not giving the I-Man faulty information. There's nothing wrong with that.
They just had it on the news.
All right, so they got back into it in 2 minutes.
The Amazon Money Network News is sponsored by Crossbin. The official pen of the... Is it? The official pen, probably are, yeah.
Can't make it up.
I don't know why they are. They are. They are, guys. Chris Matthews is coming up. Well, I think it was instructive from Brokaw that almost none of the... none of the questions that he would have asked Saddam Hussein were asked by Dan Rather. None of them. Well...
Very telling.
There you go.
Case closed.
No further comment necessary. There you go.
Dear Mr. Amos, my name is Alicia Jensen, and I am a junior at St. Mary Academy, Bayview, in East Providence, Rhode Island. Included in this letter is a donation of $2,424. On August 30th, 2001, my best friend, Ashley Silvernail, passed away from cancer. I miss her dearly, and she will forever remain in my heart. On February 1st, 2002, there was a fundraiser held in the Fleet Skating Center in honor of her. I planned the event with the help of my mom and other close friends and family members. The night of the fundraiser was a mess. It was raining. I thought we were going to have to cancel the thing. Then the rain stopped, and the night was a success. I knew that Ashley was looking down on me. Oh, sweet. Through ticket sales, raffles, and donations, we were able to raise $2,424. I'd like to donate the money to the Imus Ranch because I think it is wonderful that you allow sick children and those who have lost siblings to an illness into your ranch. It has taken me over a year to figure out where to donate the money. Ashley was such a special person to me. I wanted to make sure I donated the money to the right place. I hope this money is helpful. It'll be greatly appreciated if you could send us a confirmation once you receive the money. Well, I'll do that. Our address is so-and-so in Rhode Island. Well, that's very sweet. Alicia, thank you very much, honey. I'm sorry about your friend. But it's not, first of all, my ranch. It's that we built this ranch for these kids, so we don't allow them to come to the ranch. It's for them. So it's a unique facility in that. The original idea was to create a little house on the prairie, bonanza kind of atmosphere, where we would have 10 children at a time. We create this working cattle ranch, just, an authentic working cattle ranch. And then have all of the kids come out and stay with me and Deirdre in the main ranch house. So we'd be like their parents. But we would also have, which we do have, licensed child life specialists who also are there with the kids, doctors of oncology and nurses who are also there, and EMT people who are also emergency people who are on duty. And so it's like a big family deal. They stay there for about 10 days, and then my wife created this whole, vegetarian, vegan menu, toxic-free, whole cleaning program, and we don't use any pesticides in any of the farming or ranching. The horses are all fed and washed with natural stuff. So the whole thing is just a totally organic, toxin-free, pesticide-free environment, and it changes these little children's lives. So, and you can imagine, 10 kids doesn't sound like a lot until have 10 kids over to your house for 10 days and then get back to me on how that went. When you spend 24 hours a day with them. But it's a fabulous experience for them, and it literally changes their lives. Because no television, no radios, no nothing. I can't call home, nothing. They get up at 6 in the morning, they work, and then they learn how to be little cowboys and cowgirls. And it's a fabulous program. And it's killing me. But it's, thank you very much for the money, honey. It's, we need it, and it will, it'll go to the right place because we don't waste any money there, and, you know, I'm not charging, neither did I obviously take any salary, nor do we, I mean, that's insane. I don't charge my plane or my horses or my trucks or anything else to foundation money, so all of the money goes for what it's supposed to go for. And that's a wonderful program. I'm sorry about your little friend, and I wish you could have come out there. We'll be out there on March 21st with a session of kids, I think, mostly from New Mexico. It is 12 minutes after the hour here on the IMS in the Morning program. Chris Matthews is coming up. Chuck has a little news and stuff. How do you feel? You don't feel well either?
No, I feel fine.
I don't think so.
Various minor ailments, but I feel good.
I am in significant pain. I was actually thinking about calling Dr. What's his name?
McKenzie?
Yeah.
Sure. You can call the Ronster. The Ron man.
I don't know. If I could find those Vicodin I had, I'd take a bunch of those.
Just a fistful.
I had a whole bunch of them. I'd throw them away.
Yeah.
Not a good idea. Should always keep pain pills. Anyway, here's Chuck.
A couple of the headlines, Iman, quickly. The U.S. is sending its 6th aircraft carrier to the Gulf region in support of the war on terrorism. The USS Nimitz leaving San Diego to spend approximately 3 weeks at sea traveling to the Gulf. When it arrives, the U.S. will have aircraft carriers, the Nimitz, the Lincoln, the Kitty Hawk, and the Constellation in the Gulf, and the Roosevelt and the Truman in the Mediterranean.
Did I say the news is sponsored by Crosspins?
Yeah, you may have earlier, I believe.
Oh, it is.
And a top deputy to Chief UN Weapons Inspector Hans Blix is in Iraq to oversee the destruction now of banned missiles, which is supposed to start this weekend.
Yeah.
UN officials say Demetrius Perikos is in Baghdad to discuss the pace of destruction of the Al-Samud 2 missiles. Iraq says they're going to start destroying them tomorrow, which is the deadline set by Hans Blix to begin that work. Secretary of State Powell says it's a critical time for the U.S. and allies. After meeting with European Union ministers at the State Department, he said it is time for Saddam Hussein to finally come clean.
We in the European Union agree that it is important to keep the focus on Saddam and on his obligations to disarm. Responsibility and the decision to comply with the demands of the international community rests with him.
The government has lowered the national terrorism threat level to elevated, back down to yellow from high orange. And CBS anchor Dan Rather is defending himself against criticism for the Saddam Hussein interview.
Rather than sit there and talk to Saddam Hussein and entertain this idiotic idea about trying to establish the parameters of a debate, you know, that Saddam Hussein proposed between him and George Bush, or trying to get him to speak English, or wondering what's his favorite color, what's the one thing he wants the American people to know about him. Why not ask him why he won't disarm? Why not ask him why he's killing his own people? Why not ask him about all his chemical and biological weapons? Why not ask him about trying to assassinate George Bush? Why not ask him about shooting his own son-in-law? There's a lot of stuff you could ask him.
Sure were.
Rather's got to own up that he just didn't get it done. I was talking to Lubica last night, and Lubica, you know, sometimes these guys, they think it's just enough to get the interview. That's the big deal, you know.
That's the coup.
That's the coup. We got the interview. They didn't ask him any questions.
And permitted just a propaganda.
And these are, it's not me, you know.
No, you
might expect a performance like that out of me, but you at least would have had to brought up that when he was going on about the respect he has for George Bush, he tried to kill him. But you were obligated to bring that up unless you just didn't know what was going on.
Oh, he says Yeah, Louie got that cut. He told CNN's Larry King live last night that he understood the situation going in.
I knew that there were risks having to do with this interview. I'm not talking about physical risks. I'm talking about the risk of, you know, people saying all kinds of things about why you did it, what the motivation was, and how you might have been suckered and all of that.
Well, yeah, and you didn't ask any questions. So, you know, you don't have anybody to blame but yourself. You went in there and you went to the, you know, on this big deal about sitting in front of the mirror with these 31 or 32 questions. You didn't ask 31 or 32 questions. You asked idiotic questions. It was just, well, Nancy O'Dell would have asked.
He did everything but massage his shoulders while he was asking the question.
Yeah, I mean, what is that? I mean, you know, he didn't get it done. So, I mean, when I talked to Tom Brokaw, he wouldn't talk about Rather's interview, and I asked him what he'd ask him. But wasn't any of those questions.
No.
I mean, so, I mean, maybe Brokaw would have folded up like a $2 suitcase, too, when he got in there. Got all afraid scared.
No.
But he said he wouldn't. He said he didn't think Rather was afraid for his own safety, and I don't either. Was Ramsey Clark there in the room with him? By the way, he set the thing up, didn't he?
Yep. Interceded on behalf of the CBS organization, too, I believe, too.
Well, I mean, whether Fox News, I mean, I'm not a big fan of Fox News, by the way. But I like Brit Hume a lot, and I like O'Reilly, that's why we have him on. But, I mean, I think they're full of it. But, well, they are full of it. But, at least the perception is, because they keep saying it over and over again, is that they do the news and let you decide. But that's not what Rather's been doing, and, I mean, he's just getting called on it. I mean, Bernard Goldberg, which I defended Rather to Bernard Goldberg because I thought Bernard Goldberg's a sniveling little twit, but he happened to be right, too, by the way. But personally attacking Rather about his suits and all that, I mean, that was just chump stuff. But if you're on TV waving your pom-poms and it's clear that you're supporting Al Gore, I mean, the America doesn't want to watch that.
At least be honest about it.
Yes, and at least be honest about it. We want somebody to deliver the news. You know what? Here's the thing. It's been, I can't tell you how frustrating this is. We sit here every day, and it makes me so irritable. I say, who can we call who we can get an honest answer from about something and an objective assessment of the situation? And there almost is nobody, is there, Charles?
Well, we frequently have problems coming up with names, I know that, individuals.
We can't get anybody. Brokaw was he told her, but he delivers the news, so he can't get.
Right.
Well, you have Brokaw, Matthews, Feynman, Greenfield,
Russert.
Feynman was very honest, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Yes.
Well, so was Brokaw, but you can't get. He's got to be careful. I understand that. I don't want to put him in that position, but I mean, well, you think get any of these politicians to? I mean, they mostly tell you what they would think you want to hear. Not what they think. That's what I like about Joe Biden. I mean, he's horribly misguided, but poor thing. But at least I get the sense he's telling what he thinks. Don't you?
Oh, I absolutely do. I don't necessarily agree with you that he's horribly misguided.
As opposed to Chris Dodd and Orrin Hatch?
I think Chris Dodd's pretty good. I think Orrin Hatch is, too.
Oh.
Are you?
Well, but then the premise is going right downhill.
Well, no, but I mean, I don't know. They're not the first name to. I still think they got a little. I don't know. I'm sick of this. I'm sick of talking to these people.
Another lending success story from LendingTree.com.
I'm sure my bank would have given me a good mortgage, but I went to LendingTree.com instead. I filled out one simple form and got four offers back within hours. After all, having a good offer is good, but getting a better offer...
The only group that you can denigrate, that you can humiliate with impunity, is for poor, rural, southern folks. And that was the only point I was making.
Oh, they wouldn't do it with the Jewish family, would they?
No, they wouldn't do it with the Jewish family. And these folks that go on Joe Millionaire or the Bachelorettes, they are representing, they're just representing nobody but themselves. And America can ridicule them as individuals. But when an Appalachian family goes on the Real Beverly Hillbillies, like it or not, they're representing a whole group of people. They represent rural America. They become the face of Appalachia. And when viewers look at that, they'll be ridiculing not just that one family, but all this, but all of Appalachia. Let's talk about something else.
Okay, can I ask you if you're wearing shoes this morning? No, I'm just kidding, Senator Miller.
I am wearing shoes, and my dogs are up under the porch. They're not up under the porch, they are up under my bed.
They're in Young Harris, huh?
That's right.
What do you think?
Seriously, you endeared yourself to me forever when you were at the Georgia Governor's Mansion. And I showed you all those country music albums I had.
Yeah.
Most folks would have looked at that room full of stuff and thought that was just junk. But I could tell that you didn't. And I have a radar about folks. I can tell when folks really like country music and when they're just saying that they do. So you can just about take me on anything, and I'll forgive you.
Well, thank you, sir. Well, the truth is I wanted to steal many of them.
Absolutely.
They, as you obviously know, they caught this Khalid Sheikh Khalid Mohammed there in Pakistan over the weekend. Said to be the number three guy in Al-Qaeda and the guy who planted it.
In Holland, and the Long Island Railroad has 10-minute delays on the Far Rockaway branch due to signal problems. This report's brought to you by VH1's Born to Diva search. Think you've got what it takes to be a diva?
Yeah.
Come to VH1's Born to Diva open call at Webster Hall.
That pig screaming your guts out.
125 East 11th Street, in case you want to go this Wednesday, 9 a.m., check out VH1.com for more info. I'm Lori McNichol for the Fan Highway Patrol.
Coming up at 25 after the hour here on the I'm Mr. Morning program. Zell Miller's a good man, isn't he, sir?
I tell you, they don't come either, do they?
I always remember Charles and I. He took us up in the living quarters, the governor's mansion there when we were there. And he had a record collection of records, you know. The man, country music, but man, everything from all those original Dolly Parton, Porter Wagoner stuff, the Ray Price, Ernest Tubb. I think he had some early Elvis stuff, didn't he?
He practically had like a recorded history of country music.
I don't know if he's into the Bob Wills stuff and all that.
Please
welcome now to the I'm a Morning program, sponsored by NetJets, our friend Bo Deedle. Good morning, Mr. Deedle. Why are you all late and out of breath and all that?
No, I'm not late. I'm not out of breath.
You are late.
8:29.
You are late.
I'm never late, brother.
Here's Janice Dean with a scum report. Good morning, Janice.
Good morning. J-Lo threw a tantrum with beauty salon staff at the Miami Beach Aguna Salon as she claimed they had bungled her Brazilian bikini wax treatment.
Oh, darn.
Lopez later stormed back into the salon claiming hairs remained in hard-to-reach places.
Yo, look what you did to my coochie, man.
I can't believe that she and Ben Affleck will ever actually get married, can you?
Apparently, rumors say that he is gay.
No, I know Ben. He ain't gay.
What?
Come on.
Rumors say that he is gay, and this is just sort of a cover-up for his...
You have a lot of gay friends, bro, really.
What was the problem with?
You have a lot of gay friends, bro, don't you?
Her public hair was
don't
not
you have
what?
A lot of gay friends, bro, yes or no?
Excuse me, I do have gay friends.
Okay,
and you know what?
A lot of them.
Let me explain something. Gay
a
is not
a disturbing number of...
Excuse me, what are you...
No, I don't think it's bad at all.
Basher?
Not at all.
And if they want to put a lip lock around someone's shaft of tation, let them. I don't care, as long as it ain't mine. That's it.
You should appear on the Scum Report every day.
Hey, 2-1 odds. I got the guy in the newsroom there, Sid there on the Ephedrine. He doesn't even realize. The Vegas odds have come out already. 2-1 that Jones is favored over Tyson. Vegas odds, 2-1. Bo knows these things. My bookmaker, Jeff, called me up, and he told me right off from Vegas. He says, Bo, let him know. It's 2-1 right now if he fights Tyson. I personally don't think he can. I don't think he can handle Tyson because he's too big. He'll push him against the rope and beat the heck out of him.
Yeah. You heard it here first.
Yeah.
2-1, baby.
Yeah, I mean, Bo's on top of these things.
Damn right.
I was doing a little skiing with the kids on the weekend. Check this out. We went up to Sterling Valley, it's in Tuxedo, New York, an hour out of New York, right? Beautiful place. I got little Bo and Dana there. So I'm going backwards watching little Bo, and I fall down. I snap my neck. I thought I broke my neck, right? It snapped. It went right down my leg. I'm laying there. My daughter Dana comes running over to me. I said, boy, how would I explain this? One tough cop was a friggin' bunny hill. in Tuxedo, New York. I would have to say I was in a Rockies or something.
Right.
Please, God, don't break your neck on a friggin' bunny hill. Bo Dietl bites the dust on a bunny hill in Tuxedo, New York. Very bad. Skiing's very dangerous. Especially if you don't know what you're doing like I do.
That'd be a very suspicious death.
Yeah. Well, hey, what do you like? You like about this Muhammad, man? You know what they have in the CIA? I'm going
to
tell you something.
When you used to question people.
Yeah.
When you were a homicide detective for the.
Yeah.
New York City Police Department, a decorated one,
yeah.
I should point out. What a bit of a kiss up I am. Now, on a serious note, though.
Yeah. Torture.
Torture.
If a guy
Did
shot a cop.
Did you ever torture people?
If a guy shot a cop and we got him,
yeah.
I'll be honest with you, statute of limitations over. The honesty, there was nothing. I mean, you would really put his head in the toilet bowl. You would hang him out of building. And, I mean, at that point, if the guy killed a cop, especially, the guy used to come in and look like mozzarella cheese. That was like an automatic thing. This is no make-believe stuff. Now, as far as what they got now with the CIA, a lot of people don't realize what they do with them. They got these drugs now that they keep drugging them up. What I think they should do is tie him up, shoot heroin in the guy, let him get dependentated upon heroin, and then wave the bag of heroin in front of him like this once he's addicted, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he's going through withdrawals. Thing like this, la, 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 with the needle. You want some? But get the guy where we really want him. You know, you guys weren't mentioned this morning. Did you hear about the other attacks that they were planning on doing? They were planning on attacking the Pearl Harbor with the planes again, hijacking the planes and ramming them into the nuclear submarines when they were in the dry dock over there at Pearl Harbor.
Yeah.
So the truth of the matter is, the CIA has them in...
How long does it take to get them addicted to heroin, I wonder?
Well, I think you can do it in about... You can get them there probably... If you start shooting them some good hot stuff, you can get them going about a week. You can have them really, really where you want them. And then what you do is you dangle the thing and you become like... Make him like bait for it.
I was going to say, well, why don't we get James Taylor on the phone and ask him? Well, why would I say that?
I don't know. You're evil.
One of the sweetest guys on the planet.
Absolutely.
James Taylor.
Oh,
he's a former heroin addict. That's why you came up with that.
I understand that.
It's a brilliant idea, as a matter of fact.
I've
done that thing out of him and my friend Shelley Schultz, who handles James, and I don't know why I did that.
You know, you have nerve endings in your body,
yeah.
Especially if your fingernails. If you put somebody's hands, you tie them down, and you take pliers, and you pull the actual nail off the thing.
Well, now, come on. Yeah,
I'm talking about different types of torture.
No, but I don't want to know the specifics.
Whoa, what about when my friend there, Mr. Pearl, got a throat slashed by his creep?
That.
He had a little beautiful wife there with a beautiful baby inside of her, and this creep slashed his throat?
Oh, I'm not suggesting you shouldn't torture him.
Let me tell you something.
I don't want to know the specifics.
We're a humane society.
30 minutes after the hour here on the Amherst Morning Program.
There comes a time.
Dean sitting patiently by.
I'm sorry.
I'm exhausted.
I can tell you something. You got to even hear it. This is important. This is for the Scum Report. Who do you think was up in Rayo's last Monday night?
Don't tell us. Bill Clinton. Well, big deal.
No. I was discussing with him about what happened with Dan Rather, right?
Right.
So he's up there.
You were there with him.
Come on. Bill Clinton up in Rayo's, of course. But listen to this.
You are such a phony.
So what he's talking about, he was...
You are so phony. You're phonier than
He
said.
Was really knocking about what he was talking about. He was really knocking what Dan Rather did. He says, you know what? Dan Rather had this guy, Saddam Hussein, there. They should have put a microchip in his heel of his shoe. And when he finally got to meet him, he should have tapped his shoe 2 times, and it could take one of those 15,000-pound daisy cutter and laid one in there. We could have built a monument in Washington for Dan Rather. We could have given him the Congressional Medal.
Yep.
He would have taken this creep right out. But so Clinton says to me, Bolt, he says, I got an idea. I said, What is it? What Bush should do is let me Air Force One. I'll go there with some of these Victoria's Secret models over to Baghdad to go see Saddam, right? And I'll bring them over there. I'll bring Cuban cigars. They both like cigars a lot. And then have the girls in there and they have like an orientation, right? And they'll have one of the girls with the fake nails that they have, you know, the fake nails. They have one of these chips. While he's getting a little orientation stimulation, she puts the finger up
this
his oral rectum.
No, then they leave. This is what Bill Clinton told you.
Yeah, then they leave.
You
they get back on Air Force One,
stop
go back
screaming.
To Rayo's, right?
Now, you got
to
stop screaming
but
on the
no,
microphone.
I'm excited about
no,
what he thinks.
No, but you got to stop screaming.
What,
I mean, it's hurting my ears.
Don, what you would have...
got to stop screaming. I'm God almighty.
What you would have...
No, I want to hear the...
You have to introduce it, then.
Oh, I have to. Well, okay, here earlier this morning, I got to get Bo to stop screaming. God, I can't tell you how annoying it is. You got to stop screaming.
Excited.
Here's Tim. Well, you can get excited, fine, but you don't have to be screaming. Here is Tim Russett earlier this morning on what he would ask Saddam Hussein. If you were on Meet the Press, if you could get him on Meet the Press, what would you ask him?
Well, I think it's imperative that you really do go back to 1991. Everyone's talking about a preemptive strike, and that kind of, I think, skews the debate. I would present to him in 1991 the surrender, the ceasefire he signed, in which he promised to do two things. One, withdraw from Kuwait. Two, to destroy and identify all weapons of mass destruction. I would enforce the terms of that agreement, and I would say, this is what you agreed to. You continue to insist that you're an honorable man who tells the truth, evidence to the contrary. This is what your signature, your government's official stamp. Why don't you come forward and explain, where's the anthrax, where's the mustard gas, where's the VX? Well, we've done all that, Mr. Saddam Hussein. After that war in 1991, we sent in the inspectors. Here's David Kay, the chief inspector. He says that only because of your son-in-law telling us where your nuclear program was, the son-in-law you invited back afterwards and said all forgiven and then shot him, that we found the nuclear mother load. And that but for your son-in-law, you would today have 20 nuclear bombs in your hands. Question three. You said your only mistake in invading was Kuwait was that you didn't have the nuclear bomb before you did it. What did that mean? Question four, here is the 98 inspector's report. This is what it says you possess. And I want to show you Scott Ritter from Meet the Press on 1998 before he turned. And this is what Ritter said after he left Iraq that you possessed in terms of anthrax, VX, and mustard gas. And it is ironclad. And he can either sit and squirm, and then after we get done with the weapons of mass destruction, we can start turning into his treatment of the Kurds, his wiping out a village of 25,000 people. I would enjoy it very much, and I think that the spotlight is something that would not be kind to Mr. Hussein.
Well, here's one of the reasons that Tim Russert is not going to get Saddam Hussein to Meet the Press, because he's going to ask me a bunch of questions that are frankly none of his business, as I told him. Butt out.
The only thing more nauseating than kissing up to Hussein was Bob kissing up to Clinton at Rails the other
day. Oh, you are.
That's disgusting.
You are the most sickening, phony individual. You're my friend, but I mean, I love you, but you are so phony. Bill Clinton is the biggest pig on the planet.
And a war criminal.
And a war criminal. You want me to be honest? Yes.
You want to be honest? I was not with him. I heard, okay?
You heard what?
I heard. I heard about his idea about taking out Saddam Hussein.
Oh, well, I mean,
he wants to help our country. He wants to go there, and he wants to go there and help our country. But just think about it. They'll have a party.
He should have got Osama when he had the chance.
Yeah, that's what he should have done.
And you're going to have the fake
news. Well, were you in Rails when he was there?
I was there on Thursday night. I was with your boss.
You are.
I was with one of your underbosses. I won't mention his name.
No credibility, Joe.
Let me tell you something, but I thought it was a great idea.
Who were you with? Give me the initials.
SR's number one guy.
Who?
SR's number one guy.
Oh. Took me a while to figure it out. Jesus, what a moron I am. I mean, it's really time to think about going to the ranch.
Bob,
Or the banana. So right. I went to Rich and I said, I think he likes both. He said, so here's what you do. Pay for one, I'll give you the other, and give him both of them. So I did pay for the oatmeal and one of the muffins, but you got the extra muffin for free. I wanted to make sure you were happy.
What are you, an errand boy?
Yes.
How come you have to go get
I'll tell you why he does. Because Julie was, Sid says to her, I get this chilled oatmeal. Yeah. With soy milk in it, molasses, honey, fresh fruit.
I saw you eating it last week. It looked very yummy.
It is good. Yeah. So Julie decides to take Sid's advice and get two of them.
Well, why not get five of them for the week and put them in the refrigerator?
That was
because
my idea.
They don't keep them. So the next morning she brings one in. She doesn't tell me any of this.
Yeah, but in reality, Don... Sid is a host of a major show here.
Well, what irritated me was, one, that she didn't say anything to me about it, but two, was Sid's butting in. You would have thought, well, maybe you wouldn't.
Stay out of it, right?
So Sid butts in, so now Sid's going to go get it.
Yeah. You know. Sid, have you learned?
Well, yeah, I mean, I've learned. I won't do it again.
I mean, it's like my son put his hand on a fire at a stove. Ow, burns. So you got to learn, Sid.
I was actually looking out. Primus, but I've learned
How's that looking out for me?
Because I wanted to make sure if you wanted open, the other was going to be here at the drop of a hat.
It gets stale.
I didn't want it to drop. But see, that's so phony.
No, I mean,
just ridiculous.
Why don't we just prepare dinner for the rest of the week and put it in the freaking refrigerator?
Yeah, I mean, why don't we just
do that? It fresh, all right?
Are you nuts?
You make oatmeal fresh. It has that
savory. How do you think? I think oatmeal, soy milk, and fresh fruit is going to hold up overnight.
It's going to metabolize.
God almighty.
It's going to metisharize and all that other stuff.
Yeah, that's what it'll do. Here's Sid Rosenberg now with sports. Good morning, Sid.
Good morning, I-Man. And we've talked about it a couple of times today. Bo had the inside track on Roy Jones Jr. victory over John Ruiz on Saturday night.
Let me tell you, I watched the whole fight. Paid $49?
$49.95.
Yeah. I paid $49. I'm sure you didn't pay, but I paid $49 on it on the TV. I tell you what.
You didn't pay, Sam?
No, I paid.
I paid. What was that block? That box you told me you had? The black box?
That's not true. Come on now.
I need to go there.
Come on.
Go ahead. Come on, Sid. Sports, sir.
Well, he was talking about the finals.
Oh,
the bone.
He has no credit.
Let me tell you, the real truth of the matter, I know Mike Tyson for years since he's 12 years old as a detective. I'll tell you the honest truth. As much as I like...
What has it got to do with you know,
Mike? I'm going to tell you something. I want to tell you the fact.
You are so phony.
Physically, Mike Tyson would hit him into the ropes, and he'd pound the living heck out of him, and you can't put up against a guy 225 pounds. I don't care how good of a boxer you are. If he puts him into the ropes and starts whacking him to the side, whack, you ain't going to... I don't care all this little jabby-dabby stuff.
Yeah.
You got to take him, put him against... And that's what Ruiz did wrong. He was trying to play around. He would get hit every time. But eventually, if a guy's a real fast guy, we ever get...
But get to the point here.
He would physically use his body to pin him against...
Here's Sid with sports. Good morning, Sid.
Not a bad job. He's no worse than Larry Merchant or George Foreman, to be honest with you.
Ben, I mean, that's just a
guy. All right, let's move on and talk
about... Yeah, let's do sports.
Let's talk about college basketball.
No credibility, Bo. Zero.
Well, you know who Bo does know, though, is a guy that's in the news today here in New York City. He's all over the back pages of the Daily News and the New York Post. He's been out with Bo before, and that's David Wells.
Oh, Dave is one of my drinking buddies.
Oh, shut up with this.
Get out of Veruca. You ever hear Veruca?
He's a fat slob.
You ever hear Veruca? Go
ahead, Sid. Let's do sports.
David Wells, of course, in his autobiography.
Well, he's got to stop screaming in the mic. I don't know what to do about it, but it'll... Yeah, she's screaming in the microphone. It hurts my ears, actually. No, I have your mic off now. You can't do anything. Go ahead, Sid.
Well, it's a big story, but, of course, the biggest stories this weekend took place. College basketball yesterday, St. John's, a huge upset. Beat Duke 72-71. But as I told you earlier today, Duke has now lost 5 of their last 7 road games. So not nearly the same team at home as they are on the road.
Right.
Philadelphia 76ers won their 9th in a row yesterday. They're the hottest team in the Eastern Conference. The Nets are falling apart a little bit, I-Man. Yesterday, Stockton took the last shot, missed it. Kirilenko tipped it in, and the Nets lost at home to the Utah Jazz. Knicks lost out in Minnesota. San Antonio held Yao Ming to just 14 points yesterday.
And that's the whole NBA.
Nobody cares.
But that's all that's going on right now.
Nobody cares. What else happened?
You know what's going on tonight?
The golf thing.
Tiger Woods won match play. Now, that nobody cares about.
The yacht deal.
The yacht deal is not going on right now.
Okay, well,
maybe this will interest you. Big game tonight at Madison Square Garden, Rangers and Islanders. Does that do it for you?
Oh, God almighty. Oh, my God. I mean, they should disband both of those hockey teams. It's just absurd. And that fat pig David Wells, I was trying to take back what he said in his book.
Well, kind of. He's not really taking it back, but everybody backtracks. You know that.
He's a fat, loudmouth punk.
And Bo keeps talking to you, and I have no idea what he's saying.
No, but go ahead, Bo. What now?
First of all, I'll talk a little lower because I have important things to talk about this morning.
Get to the point.
Let me tell you about David Wells.
I'm so distressed. Here's the thing, Emma. You know what I'm going to say about? I actually believed that you had been up at the rails with Bill Clinton, and now I find out... You're such a disappointment.
He was up there Monday.
You are a... Well, I've been to Rails.
Well, I can say the same thing.
I've been to Rails with you.
I've been to Rails with the great Sumner Redstone also. You know that.
Yes.
So it's a very fine place. And the great Sumner Redstone's nephew was with me, Mr. Sweetwood, and also...
When is Sumner coming to his senses, by the way? I love Sumner.
To his senses. I'm going to tell you something. They're going to buy a piece of this thing from Europe, that other company.
Vendée deal.
Let me tell you, this is a great company run by 2 great men. But the great man, I think, is Sumner Redstone. Also, Mel's a great man.
Oh, you are such an ass-kissing weasel.
I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this again. I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. I never told anybody to lie, not a single time, never. These allegations are false, and I need to go back to work for the American people.
Tell your mama, tell your pa.
It's a Suzuki Fest.
enough.
I'll give you a minute. I'll give you 30 seconds.
Conversation is real.
You don't even know where he is now.
No.
He may be.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we don't know.
Jordan or Egypt or a place
like
that.
Who doesn't know where he is?
The CIA?
We don't.
You and me?
You and I. Yeah, no. Absolutely.
Well, they don't want to bring him back to the United States because...
You don't know where he is?
No.
Okay. I don't know if I believe that or not, but...
Charles? He has been taken to an undisclosed location.
Charles has his sources.
Does look like he could threaten him with a bar of Irish Spring, as I said earlier. He looks
like a cheeseburger.
He definitely looks like he put a few LBSs on, huh?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead, Chuck. 7 after the hour.
Time Magazine's bureau chief in Islamabad, Pakistan, Tim McGurk, interestingly, says Mohammed is suspected of being behind just a host of things.
Everything.
Including the attacks that brought down the World Trade Center.
He's the military planner of Al-Qaeda, and he's probably the man who planned and orchestrated the September 11th terrorist attacks in America. So he's a pretty big fish.
Also, the killing, possibly, of Wall Street Journal reporter Daniel Pearl, who was also indicted in 1996 for his alleged role in the plot to blow up about a dozen American airliners over the Pacific. He's suspected of involvement in the bombing of the U.S. embassies in Africa in 1998, the attack on the USS Cole in 2000, and has suggested that they got him just in the nick of time because he might have been involved in final details of a series of spectacular new attacks on New York and Washington and other U.S. targets worldwide.
Plus, they got their hands on his computers, right?
They got, reportedly have got a desktop computer and maybe more than one laptop computer along with a lot of other stuff.
Remember that stuff, that computer cop that we developed? We have a professional version out of the INS uses. No, you put code words in it, and you don't. It takes you several hours, and you take everything out of the computer. It's one of the greatest things there is right now, and the government's using it all over our country. And I'm sure they're using computer cop out there in Pakistani to go into this computer. What are you laughing about? The technology's...
I'm laughing at the fact that you're promoting it.
Well, I've been promoting. We developed the damn thing.
No, I understand that, but I mean, I didn't suggest that it was.
If you're
a laughing matter, look in your pants.
See if you got a guy...
After the hour here in the Irish program.
See if you got your boyfriend, Lance, and I take your computer, and I want to see how many times you contact Lance. I put Lance into my computer cop thing, and we download your computer, and we go right to the hard drive. Even if you put it into the wastebasket, if you delete it, I'll bring up how many times you tried to have lip lock with Lance. So, that's the technology.
We went from contacting Lance just to say hi.
To lip lock.
To selling a lip lock. Did you understand that, Charles?
No, I couldn't. I've tried, but
it could be. We will see what you deleted, what the conversation was.
Oh, I see.
And we'll see everything you and Lance
Chuck
did together.
Continues.
Iraq is crushing another batch of Al Samud 2 missiles, man.
How many this time? 3?
In Iraq, 120 to go.
2,000
of them. And this could take... You're 3,000.
Yeah, they're disarming. They're cooperating.
And Iraqi Information Ministry officials said Iraq began destroying 7 missiles this morning may eliminate up to a total of 9
You're
by
kidding.
Days
Whoa.
In.
They only have 2,000.
Well, that leaves only about 1,900 left, right? All right, come on.
And Turkey's stock market is plunging today after its parliament unable to...
No, wait a minute,
What about Turkey's stock market hurt you?
They ain't got a normal market.
Turkey has a stock market?
And it's plunging.
I find that very difficult to believe.
After its parliament was unable to muster enough votes to allow U.S. troops to operate from its soil.
The Turkey stock market.
fall is attributed to fears that Turkey could lose out on a multi-billion-dollar aid deal from the United States.
Unbelievable. 11 minutes after the hour. For lower incomes here, by the way.
Kim Jong-il is on the cover of Newsweek magazine, the other axis of evil,
haircut.
Last week. And he has those big old glasses on. And it was in the distance in my studio in Washington. And I said to my producer, Lee, I said, Wait, what the heck is Yoko on? Oh, he had that fire at his headquarters in Harlem.
Well, those these things happen.
I didn't know the George Foreman grill would cause such a... Of course, he's still on that hunger strike. That liquid diet worked out well for him. It doesn't count when you have a liquid diet and you throw, you know, New York strips in the blender and liquefy them. I'm on a liquid diet!
Wondering what to do about dry, cracked skin? Here's...
A manhole fire. The outbound George has a stall truck blocking the center lane in the upper roadway. 40 minutes on the inbound upper deck. 30 at the inbound lower level. Got a 20-minute wait at the inbound Lincoln. 15 at the inbound Holland. Triborough is slow going into Queens because of the alternate construction Manhattan bound. It is heavy but moving. This report's brought to you by Subway. Seems like winter's lasting forever, but there's heat at participating Subway restaurants. For a limited time, it's the hot and spicy buffalo chicken sandwich made with Frank's red hot cayenne pepper sauce. Subway, eat fresh. I'm Laurie McNichol for the Fan Highway Patrol.
Coming up on 17 after the hour here in the IMS morning program. Janice Dean is here with the Scum Report, and Bo Deedle's still here. And Janice comes in. And Bo says to her, don't even go over it again.
Ben Affleck, I said, happens to be a really nice guy.
No, he said, you're starting to look pretty good, Janice. Looks like you've lost some weight.
And you said she had to lose another 40.
I was just kidding around.
He said, drop down and do 40.
No, so she said she's lost some weight.
Yeah.
And then, I said earlier this morning, I didn't think there was any way that Ben Affleck was actually going to marry Jennifer Lopez. I mean, I didn't see that happening.
And then
Janice said, what, Janice?
Well, that we think that he might be gay.
She said
he might be gay. Right.
I said, no way is he gay, because I know the guy, and the guy likes the ladies. Then you said,
What is he doing with that skanky Jennifer Lopez?
Well, no. I don't think, first of all, she's skanky, but I told you what's good about her.
She is skanky.
Okay, so now you want to know what I said?
Wait a second.
What?
Where does Janice get off calling Jennifer Lopez a pig?
I didn't say pig.
I did.
Or skanky.
Well, I don't think she's skanky at all.
Yeah.
I think
she's
pretty hot, and I told you the reason.
She's gorgeous.
Bernie?
A bank account
Bernie?
To boot.
Bernie?
Where is Ben Affleck going wrong?
Bernie? Ben Affleck's friends call him Benifer.
Yeah, right.
Because he's such a pea.
Well, wait a second. She has a great butt.
Gladly.
Jennifer has a great butt.
She's a beautiful booty.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Primo.
Man, I tell you what.
This woman.
Jesus, what? I mean,
happened?
I didn't bring it up.
Where
did you lose? She's total control. She's not Christina Aguilera.
She's got a...
I like Christina Aguilera.
Sure, well, that's fine.
I think she's hot.
Jenny's a good girl. One of my home girls too, by the way.
Right.
No, Jenny is a skanky... diva. She has a staff of 20 people. 20 people.
Why skanky?
That follow her around everywhere.
Well, why is she skanky? She's had two
marriages already. She's younger than I am.
So?
She goes through men like toilet paper.
So if you had the opportunity,
this from a woman who follows some guy to Houston, by the way.
This has nothing to do with me.
Well, sounds like fine booty.
I'd like to put a surveillance team on your butt.
This is a woman who was going out with hockey teams in Canada.
Wasn't a hockey team.
Well,
it wasn't a whole hockey team.
No, okay.
Some of these Puerto Rican
we
girls
can put
doing
a surveillance on Janice, and we'll see what she does at night.
19 after the hour here in the Amherst Morning Program. Janice has the Scummy Post going on.
Well, Married by America debuts tonight on Fox. Did you know this, Bo?
Oh, man, these things are coming up. There's a new one.
Jill Nicolini from Long Island, New York, is one of the five people who will allow their family and friends to choose a fiancé for them.
She's cute. I saw a picture of her.
Well, then why does she need somebody to pick her husband?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Because it's a scam.
Maybe she's not that cute, but she's cute.
These shows are all about them becoming famous. They don't care about the opportunity to get married.
Right.
It's about getting their puss on the national TV.
Yep.
That's what it's all about. It's all about me.
Could have gone anywhere.
Yeah, could
have gone either way.
Okay. It was okay.
20 minutes after the hour here in the Amherst Morning Program.
What else?
Are you married, Bo?
No, I'm a single man.
Okay.
You're not married?
I'm a single man.
What happened?
I guess I did know something.
You know that. No, I'm just a single guy, a lot of cash, good body.
Go to Reyes.
Got a good body.
Bo could have been in the NBA.
What are you looking at me like that, Janice?
You're,
I'm not looking like you
are
at
you
anything.
Are you divorced now, Bo, or what? Or
I'm
separated or what?
I'm a single man.
Okay.
Just a single man. Right. Why are you looking at me like that?
Yeah, no, but are you really, though, Bo?
I am a single man.
Well,
Janice,
then what are you glaring at me for? Just ask the question. Why are you shooting me at daggers? Wonder about your status. That's all.
Status.
We all know that I'm attracted to married guys.
Well, haven't we had a situation? Well,
What?
Never mind.
Why don't we stop the situation? Because I got a lot of situations about you, too.
You have no situations about me.
I got pictures,
though. You have no pictures about me.
I got everything on every body.
Well, I mean, when I was single, that was a different story.
All right.
But that kiss, well, that's not exactly the situation.
Okay.
With YOU.
Okay,
Mr.
Big.
Then that'd be about fine, won't it? It is 21 minutes after the hour.
Wait a second.
Yeah, I'm just in a morning program.
Get the hell out of here.
Wait, real quick.
Wait, back up. Bo disappointed everybody here this morning with his Bill Clinton story. Well, a nightmare.
Thank you for meeting with me.
Well,
I have information, some information for listeners, about the chemical and attacks that possibly are in when. In other words, what I have here is information that state that they're not as terrifying as people think, and their only real weapon of mass destruction is the nuclear bomb, because these things have to be in such a controlled atmosphere, because they have to be in a very controlled area, and then they diminish. What happened, for a perfect example, in Japan, when that group tried to take out the people with the nerve gas, only 10% were affected by the attack of the nerve gas. Out of those 10%, 1%, 11 people, the ones that died. They thought they were going to take out tens of thousands of people, and that was the best circumstances under it. When you handle this mustard gas or anything, the person handling it is liable to be the one who's going to be diminished. So I got a whole thing here about what the smell is, what you smell. When it hits the open air and freezing, they don't work, or warm temperature doesn't work. There's so many variables here using these type of nerve gases and all. Now, also with the biological thing, the biological stuff diminishes so fast, and the best thing to do is, you get out of the area. When we had the mass, remember the escape woods that
you're
I gave
really
you?
You're really, you are just.
The people don't understand. The whole idea, and if I had time, you cut me off anyway. If I had time to explain, the fear factor is
if
more
I gave
so.
You till noon, you couldn't explain it.
They tell you in the Army, when they're training the soldiers, one drop of this could kill 1,000 people is on 60 Minutes.
Yeah.
This is all theological nonsense. The fact of the matter is, it's to gain your attention, to bring out...
It's 28 after the hour.
Why don't you theologically eat me, all right? I'm trying to talk
28
about
after
serious
the hour.
Stuff here.
You're on the Amish Morning Program. Please welcome now from Granbury, Texas, my brother Fred. I'm a sponsor by Tri-State. GBL, good morning, Fred.
Good morning. You know, when I get gas, people get nervous. Unless you get on an elevator,
Is the gas you're referring to odorless, like this gas?
Not nervous, nauseous.
No. Yeah, I see what they mean by getting in a confined place like an elevator.
So what's new with you, friend?
Yeah, nothing. Sick.
You what?
I got the flu again.
Well, I tell you.
You know, I haven't seen the sun down here in 10 days.
Why? It's been cloudy?
Yeah.
Really?
Because humidity down here.
That could mean one of two things, why?
It could.
Well, of course. It could be that you hadn't been outside.
Right.
Or,
haven't had the blinds up. Haven't opened those shades in his trailer.
Yeah. Or either that or the trailer turned over.
There's just too much humidity down here. I mean, it's as cold as I've ever been anywhere, because that humidity just goes right through you when it's cold.
Right.
It's probably not very interesting, though, is it?
No, it's not.
It's not interesting at all.
I didn't even know you could have humidity when the temperature is cold.
There's no place my brother's ever been that I've ever talked to him that he liked, in terms of the climate.
Well, think of the
nowhere.
Places he's been. I mean, he's been in some of the most awful places you could ever imagine in this country. He's never lived in one decent city in his whole life.
I was in Cleveland. I was in Cheyenne, Wyoming. I was in El Paso, Texas. We're not the garden spots of the country, you know?
Well, Santa Fe, New Mexico's not bad. It's cold.
Yeah, you know, that dry humidity, I kind of miss that dry air, you know?
Yeah, right.
But I just can't live where it's humid.
I look at it like this. If Wayne Newton has never performed in a city you've lived in, you've never lived anywhere.
So, hey, is old Ricky Rudd still running?
You picked him to win, didn't you?
Man, I'm never picking him again, you know. The whole race he was running about 24th, and he never picked up any spots till he started wrecking cars.
Right.
And then after they wrecked a few of them, he got up to 18th, and he never got by that.
You'll never pick a guy like Matt Kenseth because he's just not high-profile enough for you. Is that fair to say, Fred?
Well, he's getting high-profile, you know?
Yeah.
And Little E almost won, you know? Oh.
That's Dale Earnhardt Jr., right?
Right.
Came in second place. He did almost win.
That's what they call him, Little E?
That's what they call him down here, yeah.
Little E.
Little E running.
So, yeah, he's running good.
Well, you moved to Granbury.
It's an interesting thing. You know, just show you how those pit stops are. I mean, Gordon's crew gets a darn lug nut stuck in the impact wrench and sets him back enough to where he can't win.
That's pretty exciting stuff.
I'll be darned. They couldn't get his tire changed.
Well, it just shows you how important every aspect of...
Amen.
You know?
So let me see if I understand this. Now, you moved everything, your wife, you, your horses, everything all down, your dogs, all other junk down to Granbury, Texas, and now you decided you don't like it?
No, I'm not saying I don't like it. I'm just saying... Let me think what I'm saying here.
You're saying it's tough conditions because it's high humidity and the sun don't shine.
Yeah, I mean, the weather is rough.
Uh-huh.
You know, because there's so much humidity, and I have to live where there's a dry climate.
I'm just curious, if you decided to move again at the end of the week and you had to pack up everything, all your stuff, how long would that take?
It wouldn't take long.
32 minutes. Yeah. So what's your deal now, Bo?
Listen to me, Fred.
Yeah.
Fred, you want to listen up? Yeah. This is one of the things. If you get a sudden headache, dizziness from some source, a difficulty breathing, tightness in the chest, nausea, stomach cramps, twitching to exposed skin where there's liquid on you. If you've got these symptoms, listen to me.
I think you lost
them. Listen to me,
Fred.
No, we have.
Is he there?
Yeah.
If the answer is yes, if you panic and you breathe faster and you inhale more, that's bad. You got to get out of the area. If you have a blob of liquid that looks like molasses on your
that would be that would be yep. Fred when he takes his underwear off all of those. Oh, here's old Billy Joe Shaver.
Change your life. Call Janet Corporation of America.
I lost in New Hampshire yesterday.
That's where he is.
You lose early March, doesn't matter. You win the tournament. Nick McCarchick coaches Stony Brook University.
Oh, he does.
The men's team there?
Yes, the men's team.
Cool.
Do you, Mike, do you still stay in touch with the old alma mater?
I stay in touch with Nick McCarchick. That's where my loyalties are.
Okay, so you haven't had any conversation with Bob Hill.
We haven't chatted recently.
Did you know Bob?
Last time we talked was after the last Fordham win, which is about a year and a half ago.
Did you,
When Mike was still going to Fordham.
Hey, was Pat Riley at the Patrick Ewing celebration deal?
No, they played that night. He could not attend.
So
very conveniently.
Yeah, okay.
But didn't he call in?
He faxed in his congratulations.
No. Why does Van Gundy get such a big hand, I wonder?
Well, because they liked him when he was the head coach there.
Right.
It was a very emotional night for me.
Oh, I'm sure it was, yeah.
You know how I feel about Patrick.
And when it was all over, you looked like a milk ad.
Felt sore on Saturday morning.
Didn't you, Mikey?
Come on, tell three people. The Holy Ghost is God's cure. You don't need that cocaine. You don't need that crack. You don't need that liquor. You don't need that new relationship. You don't even need to go down to Tunica, to the gambling casino. All you need is the spirit of the gift of God.
We gotta take him out. You say. Now the only recourse is to use lethal force. You say. Nullify, crucify, liquefy. You say. I told the CIA, go shoot that dog today. You say. Those morons keep it straight, don't screw up, and terminate a great day. Not too bright, not too bright, they're just like Hussein. To get the FBI outrage off our nation's front page, Hussein. Give Iraq the big hurt, not Saddam's in the dirt. Hussein. He can push, Junior Bush, kick his tush. Hussein. Can't seem to nail down Osama, so here's a new melodrama. Hussein. Tell that Dave Gregory queer, Javet Detruir. Hussein. Here's a quote for that goat, upper that salty road. Hussein. At long last, kick his ass, take his gas. Hussein.
Copyright 2003, Infinity Broadcasting. All rights reserved. Imus in the Morning's a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment.
Imus in the Morning, Mac and Sid in middays, Mike and the Mad Dog in the afternoon, Steve Summers at night, and Joe Beningo overnights. We're the only station that talks New York sports all day and all night. That's why we're your flagship station for New York sports. The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
And good morning at 10 o'clock. This is Joe Beningo, Spring.
Good to say that again. You're on Sports Radio 66. Nice to have with us, and it feels a lot better to be in warm weather. Let it snow. I don't care how cold it is. 5 degrees with the wind chill. Freeze your little twitches off in the Big Apple. Mike and I are in Roger Dean Stadium here in Fort Lauderdale in Jupiter, Florida. Nice to have you with us as we get ready for a week of spring training on this busy day with a yes.
Khalid, shake, rattle, and roll.
Hey, Iraqi.
What's shaking?
Not our brother Khalid, Bullwinkle. The great Satan has seized him in Islamabad-red Pakistan.
Is it right? What'll happen to him now?
There is chatter to suggest there may be extradition.
Oh, why would they give him more addition than anyone else?
Because he is one of the most senior officials of Al-Qaeda.
Well, can't I'll do something to rescue him?
Doubtful, Bullwinkle. And I am sure Brother Khalid will be tortured for information.
I think being in Rat Pakistan was torture enough.
I'm afraid that in the excruciator, brother, he may reveal the location of fearless leader. How's your mama been lately?
What kind of torture will they subject him to?
The great Satan is capable of unspeakable things, Bullwinkle.
I know. I saw the final episode of The Bachelorette.
There are many insidious ways to get someone to do your bidding.
Like tell them you're a millionaire looking for a wife?
No, I mean methods of torture.
Like make them watch a TV show where someone says he's a millionaire looking for a wife?
No.
Like make them listen to Billy Joe Shaver?
No, like make him listen to this bit.
23 after the hour here in the Imus Wayne program. Please welcome from CNBC. Ron and Santa. Good morning, Mr. Sam Santa.
Good morning, Mr. Imus.
Have you read or seen excerpts of Warren Buffett's annual letter to his shareholders?
Yes.
What are derivatives?
Well, this gets to be a pretty complex area of modern finance. Derivatives are any type of investment that are based on some other security. A stock option, for instance, with which you're familiar, is based on the value of the underlying stock. When you talk about the Standard & Poor's 500, there's an index based on these 500 stocks. Then there's a futures contract that allows you to buy and sell these derivative contracts that are essentially bets on where the S&P will be in the future. So there are all kinds of derivatives. They get to be pretty complex financial arrangements when they begin to be tailored for individual clients. So derivatives can be anything from plain vanilla stock options to very complex financial arrangements.
What does Warren Buffett mean when he suggests that they could be disasters to the economy?
And I don't disagree with him on this. I mean, not at all. I mean, I've always felt that derivatives can be highly complex and highly dangerous if they're used improperly. And if they're speculated in with borrowed money, they can be very, very dangerous. And that's the one thing we really don't know about derivative usage at a lot of institutions. What he's saying is that a lot of banks, big multinational banks, have on their balance sheet some, when you take it in sum, $75 trillion worth of various derivative transactions. That's the so-called face value of these transactions. And sometimes something can go wrong in a particular area, and you don't quite know how badly the derivative will perform under a certain set of negative circumstances. You can have a big financial problem as a result.
He also says that in a section I read about common stocks, that they find very few that even mildly interest them.
Yes.
That the dismal fact is that his testimony, he writes, to the insanity of valuations reached during the great bubble.
Yep.
So does that mean, I guess that means what it says it means. There's just no stock he sees that looks good?
Well, no. I mean, he has been buying companies. You'll notice that he's been buying companies in the energy area that have been very much mauled by the collapse that we've seen in some of these kind of highly speculative energy trading companies that actually owned underlying natural gas assets, for instance. And he's been a big buyer in there. And he's found...
pending.
Pending. Try it. Right, Sid.
We got a new one coming up, right, Sid?
Careful doesn't crash the computer.
Oh, God, there's a suit the first thing up. It's suit number one. I don't want to get into it, but I'll read what it is. DirecTV suit.
I found another one. Landlord-tenant litigation.
Imus in the morning.
And Hong Kong officials recently nabbed a Pakistani man trying to sneak into the country by hiding in a passenger suitcase. The 24-year-old illegal immigrant was arrested after the Indian man carrying the baggage was stopped at the border.
Yeah.
Have anything to declare?
Did you pack your own suitcase? Anybody unknown?
Did any strangers approach you?
Oh, look, here's a mouse.
Right now, someone's doing their best.
Mr. Brian Gidinski is conducting a nationwide casting call for a new show called Mr. Personality, where a woman chooses a man from several candidates without seeing any of their faces. Instead, suitors reveal their true selves by writing love poems, performing stand-up comedy routines, and interacting with little children and puppies. Gidinski says needs of all guys and shapes and sizes will be interacting with these women and will be disguising themselves with Phantom of the Opera-style masks so that every guy gets a fair chance with the chosen hottie. And I can think of a few guys in our newsroom that would fit perfectly into Mr. Personality.
Well, what about
like,
the
Rich Ackerman?
Rich Ackerman.
Be perfect to go on that show.
Well, you know, I think Rich Ackerman is actually a mental case, don't you?
There's a few people out there that...
Yeah, he has some obsessive-compulsive behaviors.
You know, Joe Tolleson is another guy. It's not a... But, I mean, I was commenting...
He's married, though, isn't he?
I don't know. I was commenting yesterday how fat he was. The other day, how fat he was. He actually took offense. I mean, but the guy's huge.
He did get upset that day.
He did, didn't he? He's a pig. And Dove, I mean, Rabbi Dove is... I mean, that's just...
I met his wife for the first time.
She's adorable.
She really is.
Even beyond adorable.
That's a perfect adjective, yeah.
Well, she's a very pretty girl.
Yeah.
Dove is just a
beast.
It's a beast.
He is a beast.
Thank you, Charles.
He is a beast.
But he's a very nice man.
Oh, he's wonderful.
He is Mr. Personality.
He's terrific.
Oh, well, perfect. So let's say you're the woman on that show, and you go through all these guys with their personalities, and you're impressed with Dove's personality, as am I. I think he's a wonderful human being.
Right.
And at the end of the night...
He comes out,
and you're going out with Dove Kramer.
Yeah.
What are you going to say?
Where are we going?
Or Ackerman.
Of course. Why is it more and more you see these beautiful women with ugly men, but you never see a beautiful man with an ugly woman?
The bank account.
It's money. It's
you know what I was
money.
Thinking about?
Miss Kansas.
Also what I was thinking about is Cynthia's deal. What's Cynthia's last name?
Condi.
Cynthia Condi, my trainer, our trainer over at the gym, or girl's gym. She's got this new deal called... Has she started it yet?
It starts, I think, next month. The bridal boot camp you're talking about?
Oh, bridal boot camp.
Yeah.
And I thought what a good idea that was, because of how paranoid women get and how concerned they get, and I guess men too, but particularly women, of pointing toward that wedding night. I mean, I don't know any woman who's ever got married or didn't just go on a crash diet to try to lose weight.
Do you think it's the wedding night or fitting into the bridal gown itself?
Well, I don't know. What would you, if you were going to get married, what would you be most concerned about?
I never have those thoughts because I know they're not going to happen.
Most girls sleep with their fiancés beforehand, so Janice is absolutely on the money. They want to look good for the crowd.
That's true.
It's already here.
So it's more fitting into the
gown.
The cow has been milked already.
I see. Really?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So it's the gown consideration in front of all the people.
I think she would have more people coming in that want to get married, that want to trap a man. So she should have...
Well,
trapping a man boot camp.
She should have post-bridal boot camp so the wife doesn't grow the big fat ass thinking that everything is okay.
See, that's the problem.
Right.
Not a bad idea.
Right.
Look, becomes a meal, it becomes a pig.
Oh,
now, does this happen with
that's
men,
not
though?
With
or the guy, too, by the way.
Right.
Well, look at Dove. I mean, look,
exactly.
Are those such types of guys around the radio station?
Yeah.
Larry, I remember Larry Kenny. You remember Larry Kenny?
Oh,
he used to be handsome. Look at Larry. Look at Rob. Rob used to be handsome.
Dove Kramer, when we came here some years ago, was a slim fellow.
Rob weighs 500 pounds. So does Larry.
At least.
Larry is just...
Sure.
Larry, I mean, Larry washes his hair about once a week. I mean, it's just...
Would you like
Cobain? But they're getting it done. They're bringing home the bacon. Wife has to, uphold some of her duties. She has to uphold some of her duties. She has to stay tight.
Right.
Take care of the man, create an environment for him to make the money.
I've seen Rob's wife, Sharon, and she still looks great, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And so does Carol, Larry's wife.
The pressure on women is much more.
But they're both pigs. Larry and Rob are just...
Yeah. But wait a second. Do they work? Do Rob and Larry's wives work? They don't work, am I correct?
They're not the primary breadwinner.
Okay, so like, see,
well, you don't know that. You don't know that at all.
Well, I think I know these guys for a long time.
Okay, well, Sharon works, I know.
If they don't work, then it is their job to stay in shape and look good and do whatever the husband wants.
That's
while
true.
He's allowed
you
to get
are,
fat.
You, know, you
right.
really
he's
are.
He's making the money.
No, you are you are such a
it's their job is to put the way of the world.
To
pleasure their man.
What about your wife?
Oh, Jesus, God, what is wrong with you two?
My wife's in great shape. She's gorgeous, but she's a lawyer. She makes money. But if you don't go out and work and all you do is sit at home and spend your husband's money, the least you can do is keep your fat ass in shape.
That's right.
Bingo.
Back to Massapequa.
Who needs Dr. Phil?
Well, that's not a bad point.
The least he can do.
It's 29 minutes.
Or if you're Robert Blake, you just shoot them if they get nice.
There you go.
Get out of line.
Hey.
You open your mouth.
The latest on Robert Blake, by the way.
Get away with it.
You got to do what you got to do. I mean, I would say that. I mean,
oh, my God.
No.
No, I'm just kidding.
Oh,
no.
My God.
I got the hunger for your love, and I'm waiting in your welfare line.
I'm missing them all. Listen, Bob, we've been dating for a while.
But I'm Ann Fan.
That's starting off the right way.
In Semple, Virginia.
There you go.
Delbert McClinton is playing our local honky-tonk this Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
I'm taking my Harley, Shane.
Now, there is an Imus in the morning.
No, that's
welcome, I.M.
The Yale workers are lazy and overpaid.
There you go.
They get very good compensation, 30 days vacation, first dollar medical coverage, no copay for families, and up to $8,000 per year toward college education for each child. Stop whining and get back to work, it's a bunch of deadbeats.
Not according to Jesse Jackson. Says the Yale University, quote, is too rich for the workers to be so poor.
Don't worry, I-Man. The hospital is not affected by the strike. It's just the university. Go see the doc and stop bitching already. Well, Dr. Mathey teaches at the university.
Yeah, I mean, there still could be some
and
sort
and
of...
It affects the food service at the...
Yeah?
What if I go see Dr. Mathey and I want to get a snack?
And the dining hall workers are on the picket line.
Hey, Imus, how do you feel about the Dan Rather interview with Saddam? Would love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, what were they, Imus?
As usual, J.C. Watts was great.
Amen.
David Gregory is a liberal pussy.
True.
I wonder why I hated Gregory.
Well, you can't hate David Gregory.
What's the matter with you people? Come on here. He just said David Gregory's all right.
I'm just misguided.
Howard Dean is not a moron. You are mistaken. No, I'm not. He is a moron,
please.
Jonathan Alder is a disgrace.
Total.
He'll be the next one to get a suck-up interview with Saddam.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I love Alder, too. I like him a lot. But to suggest that Rather couldn't ask the questions that either Tom Brokaw or Tim Russert said they would have asked, it's preposterous if the excuse is because the Iraqis had control of the tape.
Yeah, but shut it down. Shut down the interview.
Well, fine. Let them shut it down.
Who cares? I mean, what purpose did it serve?
It don't put Saddam Hussein on television for 60 minutes and make him look like Gandhi.
The father of the bride, or the benevolent...
That was my only point. Please. I mean, that's just absurd. 12 minutes.
Total dope.
After the hour here on the... I'm just wondering, what else, Chuck?
The U.S. is expected to call for a vote in the Security Council next week on this new resolution to authorize military action. And Senator Ted Kennedy told NBC's Today Show there's too much going on here at home to launch such an attack.
We are still facing the danger of Al-Qaeda here at home. We need to do more in terms of homeland security. We have the North Korean situation right on our front plate this morning, and we are about to go alone in the Middle East.
The staff might want to, he has the best staff in Washington, they might want to rehearse the notes that they give him to read when they wheel that fat lug out there and have him make some one of these idiotic statements that he makes.
The senator says that military action to disarm Saddam Hussein would destabilize the region and destroy any goodwill that has been built up in the area after September 11th.
What goodwill?
That's what I was going to...
What are you, nut?
...wondering as well.
Here now, some breaking news just reaching the Imus in Washington network headquarters. In an undisclosed location somewhere near Pakistan, U.S. intelligence agents say they have just broken key al-Qaeda operative Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. Attorney General John Ashcroft made the announcement at the Justice Department.
Well, after days of intensive endeavor, I'm pleased to report success in our efforts to derive information from Mr. Mohammed. Now, while some will question our methods, life and limb were at stake. We tried the normal techniques, the sleep deprivation, bum cuffs, ball peen hammered to the nads, but success eluded us until we applied a method so horrible and inhuman that I'm ashamed to describe it to you. But yes, with Mr. Mohammed restrained, we played at an extreme decibel level. Daryl Waltrip sang boogity, 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 as recorded at the start of the Daytona 500. Mr. Mohammed immediately spilled his guts and then died. The Attorney General expressed gratitude to NASCAR's cooperation in the nation's anti-terrorism effort by generally making terrorist agents, and a lot of people for that matter, either die spontaneously or want to kill themselves. On the other side of the issue, concern deepens for the well-being of actor Mike Farrell of the group Artists United to Win Without War. It is thought Mr. Farrell may have had a stroke after he appeared on NBC's Meet the Press
deeply confused, and in fact, unable at any time to place in their proper order subject and predicate. Dr. Robert Thornton of the National Institute of Neurological Disorders and Stroke.
After watching Mr. Farrell, I am persuaded that he has either suffered some profound diminution of cognitive ability or is just the dumbest son of a bitch to ever attempt the language processing requirements of common human communication. Frankly, we've had better results with monkeys. Rather than trying to talk, I'd suggest Mr. Farrell could be a far more effective anti-war influence by becoming a human shield.
On that matter, however, confusing news from Iraq, where many so-called human shields who traveled to Baghdad from Europe are returning to their homes because, quote, they feared for their safety. If I may be permitted an observation, am I missing something here? Lars Jagerfeld is a human shield returnee who had volunteered from his native Amsterdam.
Well, we didn't understand the extent of our obligation. I mean, this was a great trip for a while, you know, doing a lot of weed, hanging out, you know, party. But Jesus, somebody's going to bomb us, and we're supposed to just stand there? What do I look, stupid?
In a word, Mr. Jagerfeld, yes.
Yeah, well, and another thing, where's the Sean Le Pen now?
I don't know. Under his bed.
Also from Baghdad today, word that Saddam Hussein has now agreed to not only destroy all of his controversial Al-Samud II missile stock, but also all of his nerve gas, biological munitions, nuclear facilities, and every other conceivable item associated with any weapons of mass destruction capability or research. At the UN, Chief Weapons Inspector Hans Blix hailed what he called Saddam's total capitulation to avoid hostilities. At the White House, President Bush welcomed the Iraqi leader's compliance and announced that bombing of every square centimeter of Iraq would commence immediately. Our microphones were there.
While we think that Saddam getting rid of everything, you know, is good, I have to confirm with Secretary Rumsfeld, Cheney, Deputy Defense Secretary Wolfowitz, that boy's nuts, let me tell you, scares me. Oh, and also that little old black gal around here was in on it. I've decided that the only course of action left is to smoke that sumbitch. And if I can slip by everybody, smoke that sumbitch Dan Rather, too, before he can kiss his ass again. Turncoat turd.
On that subject, and finally, CBS has announced a new reality show along the lines of NBC's popular Fear Factor program, but based on Dan Rather's Saddam Hussein interview. The network says the concept is simple. Once a week, Dan will interview a well-known despot in some corner of the world, and a panel of viewers will see how long they can watch without throwing up.
Now, wait a minute.
What's wrong with my lip?
Well, you remember that, don't you? Baby, I did 29 pictures like that.
Hey, Elvis?
Yeah, that's all I could move in Florida.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the police filmed a show one time in Florida because the PTA, the YMCA, or somebody, they thought I was something. And they said, man, he's got to be crazy. So the police came out and they filmed a show. So I couldn't move. I had to stand still. The only way I moved was my little finger like that. You know, the whole show.
Another lending success story from LendingTree.com.
I'm way too busy to get a line of credit right now, so I'm letting...
to destroy their weapons of mass destruction. As we join them now, they are discussing the ramifications of the capture of fellow terrorist Khalid Sheikh Rattle and Roll.
Hey, Iraqi, what's shaking?
Not our brother Khalid Bullwinkle. The great Satan has seized him in Islamabad, Red Pakistan.
Is it time? What'll happen to him now?
There is chatter to suggest there may be extradition.
Oh, why would they give him more addition than anyone else?
Because he is one of the most senior officials of Al-Qaeda.
Well, can't I'll do something to rescue him?
Doubtful, Bullwinkle. And I am sure Brother Khalid will be tortured for information.
I think being in Red Pakistan was torture enough.
I'm afraid that if they excruciate our brother, he may reveal the location of fearless leader. How's your mama been lately?
What kind of torture will they subject him to?
The great Satan is capable of unspeakable things, Burwinkle.
I know. I saw the final episode of The Bachelorette.
There are many insidious ways to get someone to do your bidding.
Like tell them you're a millionaire looking for a wife?
No, I mean methods of torture.
Like make them watch a TV show where someone says he's a millionaire looking for a wife?
No.
Like make them listen to Billy Joe Shaver?
No. Like make him listen to this bit.
Coming up on 25 after the hour here in the Amateur Morning Program, Janice Eden and Sid Rosenberger here. Sid, just when I got my chilled oatmeal from Richie and... you know, it's a disturbing thing is that I actually spilled some oatmeal on my shirt. Did it actually drop out of your mouth onto your shirt?
Wait,
that's possible. You know, you do have a little tiny piece on your chin.
Yeah.
Oh, that's all. I rest my case.
Oh, my God. In the corners of your mouth, coming down.
So I've reached the point where there's oatmeal on, that I have oatmeal on my face. On your chin.
On my chin and on my shirt.
And it fell out of your mouth on your shirt.
Yeah.
Maybe you should make an Imus bib.
And fudge on your underwear.
Well, it's time.
Get a toe tag,
right? Yeah, it is time.
That is not good. Here's Janice with the scum report. What's going on?
The latest on the Hollywood has-been actors killing their wives and girlfriends. A stuntman is claiming actor Robert Blake solicited him to kill his wife, Bonnie Lee Bakley. Ronald Hambleton worked with Blake on the set of the TV show Beretta. He testified yesterday that Blake had tried on numerous occasions to find out how much it would cost to have his wife, Bonnie Lee, killed. Hambleton says that Blake explained that he would need to start taking money out of his bank in small denominations over a period of time so that he wouldn't be withdrawing all of the money at once.
Got to be really careful with this.
As the hearing got underway last week, another stuntman testified that Blake had also made him an offer of $10,000 to, quote, pop his wife.
Why does he got to be careful with this?
What's that?
Well, if you're going to go about having your wife whacked.
Alone.
Oh, okay.
You don't want to end up like Blake.
Step by step.
Right. I understand.
You with him?
Yeah.
Martin Sheen is under pressure to curb his anti-war stance if he wants to keep his role in the West Wing. NBC is under pressure to get rid of Sheen, who attended anti-war rallies after the channel's executives received hate emails accusing the actor of being a traitor and un-American.
We could always get a job at CBS News.
Yeah. Rather than give him about ready to retire or scale back his activities.
CBS Evening News with Martin Sheen.
Yeah.
He's done a great job. I think he's won... multiple Emmys. He's beaten out James Gandolfini a couple of times.
He's good at reading a script.
Yeah, he's a very good actor.
Yeah, but somebody else writes for him. Yeah.
That's right.
Oh, so the actor, so what you're saying basically is the actor doesn't mean anything.
Exactly. It's not rocket science.
Ding, 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 ding,
very
ding.
Good. So what separates a good actor from a bad actor then?
Good script. Luck.
What?
A good agent.
Yep.
That's why you're not in the movies yet. And Britney Spears has hired a lookalike to go clubbing with her because she's so afraid of stalkers. According to The Star, one of Britney's butt wipers came up with a decoy idea after hearing Saddam Hussein has lookalikes because he fears assassination.
Britney Spears. Oh, my God.
Stalk them both, then.
I mean, it's just no way to, I don't know.
Scum website of the day? Here you go.
Yeah.
CelebritiesEating.com. Real celebrities eating real food. See the pictures the stars don't want you to see. Hillary chomping on a McRib. Star Jones getting a big view of her cheeseburger. And Al Roker with a big old piece of fried chicken.
Oh, my God.
Great.
CelebritiesEating.com.
28 after the hour here on the...
I-Man eating his oatmeal.
That would be really ugly.
Holy half of it,
can't make it up.
The oatmeal falling, I mean, dribbling down my chin and getting on my shirt. I mean, it's just...
That'll be a daily occurrence in like a month or...
That is really distressing. What's coming up in sports, Sid?
Well, we've got, Latrell Sprewell's in big trouble, it looks like, now, I'm in.
Well, what happened here?
Well, he pays child support. He had this high school sweetheart he's no longer with, obviously, and he's been paying this girl who's got a 14-year-old kid about $2,000 a month, which comes out to $24,000 a year, if my math is right, and Latrell Sprewell's going to make $12 million this year. And last year, when he broke his hand and got himself into trouble, the ex-wife who was the baby, was nervous that he would stop paying it. So now she wants more than the $2,000 she's been getting from her, and I think she's right. So that's one story in the news. Charles Sprewell, Pete Rose is in the news. David Wells is in the news. We've got lots to talk about.
Okay. When does March Madness start? Much as you would know, but...
No, that's not true. I did my homework after I was incorrect a couple times ago.
You were embarrassed earlier this morning. I had no idea when it starts.
I got to be honest. It takes a lot to embarrass me.
I think we've seen that, yeah.
Just answer without even knowing. Oh,
yeah.
No. Am I wrong? Okay.
March 16th is a selection show. That would be not this Sunday. The following Sunday would be the selection show.
Right.
And then, of course, 3 days after that, Thursday, would start the NCAA tournament, which would be the 20th.
Right.
So we are a week and a half away from the selection show and 2.5 weeks away from the actual start of March Madness.
I go to the ranch the 21st, which means...
You'll be out there for all the action that Friday, which means you won't see any of the games.
Right.
Because you don't have any television out at the ranch.
I have a television, but I won't be able to watch it because of children there.
Well, you could set aside a couple hours a day if you...
No.
No.
That's not going to... No, that's not the way it works.
No.
So it's...
Nope.